interested in becoming a team member, all you have to do is shoot me an email, and we can send you an invite to make sure that you're a part of the team. That includes the pediatric emergency medicine fellows as well, if you haven't seen the emails, or if you have not requested to be a team member, all you have to do is send me an email. The cool thing about this platform is that we can actually do a number of things with it. It actually archives a lot of the conversations that can take place. You can talk to each other that are members of the team. You can also pose questions and have discussions on larger forums, larger boards. There's actually multiple channels. There's a general channel. We actually have a channel for conference as well, which is what we're using today to really just enhance our learning and discussions of the various topics that have been presented. So just wanted to get that out there, and it's just something that I'm personally excited about. Hopefully, there's some other individuals, some cool stuff that I've seen people doing with it. There's actually a Nerd Alerts channel that Dr. Dukas started. So I'm gonna find some nerdy stuff to post on there. Nerdy EM stuff, of course. But just wanted to get that out there. So onto our next talk, actually. This is very, very special. Probably the next presenter is one of the reasons why I'm actually not only an EM, but also part of this program. And actually, I don't think I can do him justice.
You're awesome.
Oh, thank you very much. I don't think I can do him justice, though, in terms of the introduction. And so with that said, I actually asked for some help from Dr. Lucas.
Thanks.
Hey, guys. Good morning. Good morning. So, I'm going to use the chair's prerogative and talk about just two or three minutes about Christopher Doty and Max Doty. The Max, by the way, has already gotten early admission for our class 20 years from now. So it's our class of 2037. Max is going to be one of our interns.
2040, actually.
In 2040?
I've already calculated.
All right, good, okay. All right, so Chris Doty, for those who don't know, is a graduate of our class of 2001. If you talk to the grads of the class of 2001, they will tell you it is the best class that ever graduated from this program. And it was a tremendous class. You had Mark Silverberg, you had Raheem Ardolik, you had Laura Melville, you had Jeff Levine, Kim Tranquada. I mean, really, 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 stellar people. And whether it was the best class or not, I'm not actually certain, but let me tell you a little bit about this. Roger Holt and Elmer Johnson think the class of 2000 was the best class that there ever was. So let me just tell you a little bit about how Chris came into our program. So it actually was 20 years ago, maybe just shy a month or two, it was in the fall of 1997. When we were interviewing, and it was the last day of interview. And in those days, I was young, so I interviewed. And it's very arduous. If you don't know, it's very difficult for the program directors and the chiefs that are there. It's just like week after week, either 1 or 1.5 days, it's just horrible. It's a lot of work. And then you have to make very, very important decisions. So it was the last day, and I interviewed Chris Doty on the last person of the last day. And we're sitting across my desk from each other, and my desk in those days was Dr. Rinner's office. And I looked up at him, and I looked down at his application, and I said, "Doty, what are you doing here?" And he goes, "I'm not exactly sure." And I said, "I'm really tired." And he said, "You know, sir, I'm pretty tired too. It's a long season." I said, "Okay." And we just started talking. I don't think we talked about anything in emergency medicine. It wasn't, and I've always had a tremendous people skill. It wasn't 4 minutes into the conversation that I knew that I needed this guy in my program. He came, we were very fortunate enough to, we convinced him that we were really hot stuff, and he ranked us very high. We ranked him extremely high. And he came here. He was a phenomenal resident, a tremendous chief, even in his residency. He started showing the nation that he was going to be a national educator, a tremendous educator. And we were extremely fortunate to keep him as faculty. He was our associate program director, and then he became our program director. And he was our program director for quite a while. He has gotten every single educational award offered in the United States of America. From every major society, there is no one who's been more decorated as an educator than Christopher Doty. And we were, you know, it is just a pleasure to have watched him grown from a guy who didn't know what the hell he was doing in Brooklyn 20 years ago to what he is right now. But he's not only a phenomenal educator, a tremendous emergency medicine physician, and a leader. He's also obviously a fantastic father and a wonderful husband. I want to tell you one quick story about Christopher Doty. So he was in the program, and he's here, and now he comes as a faculty. He's a junior faculty, and there was a conference we had down in New Orleans. And so we all went down. I love New Orleans. I've been there at least a dozen times, one of my favorite cities. But 15 years ago, it was a little bit of a tough town, especially if you went off the beaten path. So there's about 12 or 15 of us, and we're going to eat at whatever restaurant, and we're walking through the streets in New Orleans. It's a little bit on the outskirts. We're walking there, and the group is a little bit ahead of us, and I'm walking in the back with Dr. Doty, and a homeless guy comes up to him and says, hey, buddy, you got some money? You gonna give me some money? So I said, come on, let's get out of here. And Chris says, hold it. He said, what are you gonna do with the money if I give you the money? He said, I'm gonna go buy some food. And he goes, really? He goes, yeah, I'm telling you the truth, I'm gonna go buy some food. He said, all right, come on, let's go. So he said, well, what are we doing? He goes, I'm gonna go buy some food. So we walk, and I'm like, oh God, here we go. Here I am, how am I gonna explain to my family I get stabbed in New Orleans? So we go down this block, and all of a sudden we're in this little kind of eatery, and goes up to the counter, asks for a menu. Gentleman sits down, Chris says, what do you want? He picks out what he wants. Chris calls over the person behind the counter and says, we're going to have all this, and please give me the bill. I'm going to pay for it right now. Guy comes over with the bill. Chris gives him the bill. Gives him the money. Boom. We walk in. We walk out. The man says, thank you, mister. And he says, you know, you be careful. You take care of yourself. That's the kind of person that Christopher Doty is. So he's not only a rock star when it comes to emergency medicine. He's a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful person. So he left us to become the vice chair at University of Kentucky, and program director and vice chair at University of Kentucky. And it was a transition, and he transitioned the PD role over, but he's still the vice chair. And actually, next year, he's going to be the president of CORD in the country. And I'm sure he'll do an absolutely fantastic job. So I want you to put your hands together for a tremendous colleague, a tremendous educator, a tremendous clinician, and a very, very dear friend, Dr. Christopher Doty.
That's quite an introduction. Checks in the mail, Mike. So I'm going to start out, I'm going to take some of Marcel Brooks' thunder, which I love to do. Dr. Shaw, Dr. Center, Stefan, Mike, the people that taught me how to be a clinician, and how to be an educator, how to be a program director, and how to care about people, how to care about the patients. We're going to talk a little bit about you and less about the patients, and we'll talk about why that's important. So building resilience in emergency medicine, and it's not really emergency medicine because this can be applied to other fields. We're going to talk about building resiliency in yourself. Now this has taken a lot of, quite a head of steam over the past year or two. I do have something to do with that, and that not in a good way. But this, you're hearing more about this than you did 4 years ago, that's for sure. So if you don't focus on this for yourself, you're not going to be able to take great care of the patients. And this is something that was foreign particularly to programs like Kings County. And we'll talk about why that is. In way of disclosures, there is no money in wellness. I'm not paid by anyone to give this talk. I'm not on any speaker panels or reimbursements. There's no money to be made yet. We have a pretty basic prescription for our presentation objectives. We're going to talk about some awareness. You're not going to get a bunch of statistics here. We'll talk about some recognition and a prescription for action. So mostly what I want you to do is just look at yourself. Think about what you can do to make your resilience better. Because if you come out of this presentation without the sort of a little bit of an aha moment, you haven't helped yourself and you're not going to help your patients. So if major learning points, so if you fall asleep, if you go to this Twitter stream, the major learning points are actually coming out as I speak. So if you follow that Twitter stream, Papa's Pearls, then you'll get the things I want you to get. There are not a lot of statistics. There's a few, but you're not going to get a huge data dump, right? I'm just going to talk to you, and I want you to think and be introspective. Does anybody know this? We used to have this huge California pipeline. Anybody know this story, what this is about? So this happened to LA County. This guy was a resident, I'm not sure what year, at one of our sister programs. He basically took care of a young man who had been shot. Young patient expired. This guy went out, took sort of a moment, cried a little bit. This picture was shot by EMS, by an EMS worker. This guy then stood up, went back in, finished out his shift, showing tremendous resilience. Resilience is defined as your ability or a substrate's ability to be sort of changed, displaced, and then to snap back into shape. And for humans, it's really your resiliency is your ability to face adversity. So a little bit about me, you've heard a little bit about this. So I've been an emergency medicine educator for 15 years, program director for the vast majority of that time. I started the EMIM program here. I've trained about 350 residents in my career, so there are some objective successes in my career. But I stand in front of you as a complete failure, because I failed at the most basic requirement of being a program director. And it's because of this man. So this is Carlos Sanfoss. Carlos was a PGY2 resident at the University of Kentucky. He graduated from UK. We got him into the program. Sort of a goofy kid, but very well liked. Handsome, smart, empathetic. He grew up in a lower class white neighborhood in northern Kentucky. So he saw these people, the citizens of Kentucky, of the Commonwealth, as his people. And he cared about them deeply. And he was doing great in the program. About September of his second year, it's a three-year program, so getting close to halfway, his mother got sick. His mother was sort of languishing in a nursing home in northern Kentucky. He was driving 90 minutes each way, almost all the way to Cincinnati, to see her before and after every shift, so adding 3 hours onto his day every shift. And he began to sort of drop off in his performance. I am a relatively hands-on program director, so when his performance dropped off, I was on him like white on rice. Right? What's going on? What's going on, Carlos? You know, you're not doing as well as you normally are. What's up? So he said that his mother was very sick. She had bad liver disease, and she was in a nursing home. He shared some of the results from her care with me. We were able to get her transferred down to a hepatologist. I work at UK, which is a quaternary care referral hospital. We have every specialty. So we got her seen by hepatology. She was admitted to the ICU within about 12 hours of presenting in the clinic. So she was relatively sick. Her MELD score, if you're familiar with MELD score, the EMIMs are, was 40. It's not good. So I took Carlos off clinical service. I was meeting with him every couple of days. I was texting back and forth with him. I was on him. But I had been through this before. I'm a relatively experienced program director. So took Carlos off clinical service. I made this elective in his second year, put him on the elective. He basically was spending all his time with his mom in the ICU. She was intubated, unconscious. I got a call from one of my colleagues in the ICU that said, hey, I haven't seen Carlos in a couple of days. And I said, oh boy, that's not good. He said, yeah. So the last conversation I had with him was about goals of care for his mother and whether we should be talking about curative goals of care or palliative goals of care. And I haven't seen Carlos since that conversation. So I freaked out. It's the middle of an interview day, so I have 12 candidates that are in sort of at UK looking at the program. I can't just evaporate and go look for Carlos. So I call up one of Carlos's colleagues, say, please go to Carlos's house, find out what's going on. Door's locked, can't get in. I said, get inside the house. I said, call the police. Police came, said he hadn't been missing for very long, he can't do anything. Police left. So I instructed my resident, I said, get inside the house. I don't care what you blow a hole through the door if you have to. I want you on the other side of that door. I'm calling you in 30 seconds. And Carlos had taken his own life in an acute grief reaction about his mother. So the person who's responsible for taking care of the residents, right? The mother hen is the program director. That is the person responsible for your wellness, or they delegate that to somebody else. And I failed at the most fundamental thing of being a program director. I tell you this story not to bum you out, but to engage you. This could be you. Carlos was doing well in the program. UK is not the most rigorous program in the country. Right, the residents have an okay life. So this is me, young, devastatingly handsome. I think I have the world by the tail. This picture was taken at UHB, actually, probably back in 2002. I'm not gray yet, so I'm not married yet. I think I have the world by the tail. I got this vice chair thing down. I know how to do the program director thing. I have a wife. I have a beautiful son. I am happy. And I get just out of nowhere, this thing hits me. And it is the worst day of my professional career, hands down. I just feel obliterated. And I am suddenly aware of my complete incompetence as a program director. That my residents know more about this ECMO circuit than they do about wellness. This, some of you, 5-6% of you in the foreseeable future will have anything to do with an ECMO circuit. 65% of you will have something to do with wellness, right? 65% of trainees are burned out. But I'm not the smartest guy, but I will outwork anyone, right? And this is a quote my father always used to talk to me about. He said, you never lose. You either win or you learn. So I completely changed my professional focus. I was a CHF nerd before that, talked about educational theory and curricular models, and I still nerd out about that stuff. But now, I'm shouting from the mountaintops about resiliency. So I want you to look at these 12 stages. We begin here, it comes down, and up to here. And you probably find yourself sort of vacillating between these two. If you don't see yourself somewhere on this spectrum, or you don't see yourself somewhere on this spectrum over the course of your residency, I don't think you're being honest with yourself. Every single one of you is somewhere on here, or has been. And I can look at times in my life when I was here, and times in my life when I was here, and everywhere in between. So how do we do that? How do we become resilient? How do we be that flower that sort of sprouts up amongst the pavement? Burnout has been described mostly in the helping professions, nurses, pastors, police officers, firefighters, physicians, other caretakers. Now, we talk about Lindsay Lohan getting burned out at this point, right? So it's been extrapolated to other fields, other occupations, but truly, burnout is for the helping professions. And this is what happens, right? People get, anybody here chronic fatigue and exhaustion? Nobody? Yeah. Increased risk-taking, and that's not just medically, it's in your personal life, increased risk-taking, not wearing your seatbelt, increased risk-taking with sexual choices, increased risk-taking with other things that you do, with relationships. Self-criticism, feeling of helplessness, feeling of being besieged, cynicism. That never happens in emergency medicine, right? We don't utilize any dark humor. But is there a problem? I mean, is this something we need to talk about? Can we please move on to tumor lysis syndrome? Right? Well, there's a rough road ahead. Some days you're going to have good days, and some days you're going to have bad days. But if we don't have strategies to deal with this resiliency, this is our fate. You are twice as likely as general population to commit suicide, each one of you. There's something specific about the MD degree. Lowest risk is for high school educated people, next bachelor's, next master's, then PhDs, then JDs, and then dentists, and then doctors. So there's something specific about the MD or the DO degree that puts you at risk. 400 doctors a year commit suicide. How many graduates are in the SUNY? Who graduates SUNY Downstate? How many people in your class?
120.
So three full SUNY Downstate classes every year. Three full classes every year to make up for the attrition due to suicide. And this is what, these are the people we know about. Right? This is not, I am sure that there are high velocity single car accidents into bridge abutments, right, that are physician suicide, but they don't want to get tangled up in the stigma of suicide. They don't want to get tangled up in the consequences in your life insurance policies, for some life insurance policies, for those you leave behind. This is an astronomical number. An astronomical number. 10% of fourth year students and interns consider suicide. Right, these are huge numbers. Doubling physicians, 46% of all physicians report burnout. 60% of all physician trainees. A new paper came out by Raj, 65%. Where's emergency medicine? Right, depending on what literature you look at, we are at the very top. Right, so all this emergency medicine burnout stuff that I heard about when I was a resident, and I heard about when I was a student, people said, no, it's just, the people that are burning out are people that didn't train in emergency medicine. It's not true. It's not true. We thought it was true. And it was certainly true that people that had trained in other specialties and never trained in emergency medicine, when they practiced emergency medicine, they had a higher rate of burnout. That is true. But there's something about emergency medicine. But look at dermatology. Dermatology is 37%. Dermatology. They just hack off moles, 9 to 5. My bank is open more often than a dermatologist. Right? 37%, and up to 53% in critical care. And no matter what data you look at, right? This is mean burnout, emergency medicine's at the top here, right? So this is just a different data set, but we're high. We're super high, and it's because the people we take care of are super sick. And you have a front row seat to the ills of society. Young people getting shot, old people being neglected and abused, child abuse. You have the front line seat. You see it first. That's what this is about. The sicker your patients are, the more acute your patients are, the higher your risk of burnout. Causes of physician burnout is not gonna surprise anybody. Non-physician tasks, people want more with less. There's long hours, patients are not always happy, right? We have the ability to see patients on the worst day of their life. They're usually ticked off, right? No one's really happy to see you. And I was struck, this picture was taken in Kentucky, not in Lexington. But I was struck with the idea that we have identified all these occupational hazards for this construction worker. He's got a helmet, he's got goggles, he's got a respirator, coveralls, he's tied into the scaffolding, he's got these gloves on. So we found all these things that are occupational hazards for this man. We've protected him. We've made it rule. Right? If he doesn't have his hard hat on, his foreman comes and screams at him. Have we identified occupational hazards for emergency physicians? And are you adequately protected? Does it matter? Oh man, that was supposed to be Stefan's picture in there. Well, maybe that is. Actually, it's a famous emergency physician named Vicki Noble, who's an ultrasound person, was at Harvard, now in Cleveland. There, that's better. So I think of wellness as a wheel, and if you look at wellness wheels, you can find 7 spokes, you can find 4 spokes, but I like this one. So environmental wellness is the way you interact with your environment, right? Do you keep a tidy work environment? Do you keep your house picked up? Do you leave your dishes in the sink for a week and a half before you do them? How do you interact with the world around you? Financial wellness is what you guys all think you have bad financial wellness, right? And you do. You're very, wait, there's more, right? You're in debt, right? At least 100,000, about 20% of people actually have no medical school debt when they graduate, but most people have 100,000 or more. Some people, about 18%, have more than 300,000, right? So a lot. I will tell you, from the other side, that your financial wellness is going to be fine. You are going to be firmly entrenched in the top 1% of earners in this country. Now, New York City, there's a lot of people that are top 1% earners, right? But you're never, ever going to be going through Kentucky Fried Chicken garbage bins looking for food, right? You are going to do fine. Right? Physical wellness is what we focused on. The ACGME focuses a lot on sleep science, and we talk about how the shifts roll forward, and are you getting exercise, and are you eating well? Emotional wellness is how you feel. Right? This is often what we think about our mental state. Are you anxious? How do you feel today? Social wellness, extraordinarily important, something we don't think about very often, but is your connectedness with the other people around you. Your support network. Intellectual wellness is essentially mental exercise, your lifelong learning. Spiritual wellness is living within your value system, your ethics, your morals, those of you that have them. And sexual wellness is one that I added in because I think it's exquisitely important. And it's you know, being comfortable in your own skin, comfortable with your sexual choices. Imagine how devastating it is to not be comfortable in your own skin. Right? To not be comfortable or not be able to live the way you want to live as a sexual being or make sexual choices or feel like you're going to be ostracized because you're attracted to somebody of the same sex. Or you feel like you're trapped in the wrong sex, you know, gender. So let me tell you a story. Cast your mind, 2005. Most of you are probably in diapers at the time. But this was the first time that I really bottomed out. So I was previously married. I didn't always have a kid and a wife. My wife and I began to fight. We were not well suited for each other. We were when we started dating 15 years previous, but the wellness wheel starts to chip away. I don't feel very good about it. I'm upset, feel like a failure, not getting my medicine. Stop going to the gym, pork up a little bit, well over 300 pounds at the time. Get more depressed. Start going to the gym a little bit more, spending less time at home. Weight comes down again, I start to feel a little bit better. Not any happier. We get divorced. Financial wellness, boom, gone, right? Divorce is devastational, even if you don't have money. My intellectual wellness, my spiritual wellness, I'm not performing very well at work. Like, I'm irritable, or more irritable than I normally was. And then when you divorce, you don't just split the china, you split friends. My ex-wife is much more likable than I am. She got most of the friends. I got most of the debt, which is fine. But you can see how this cascade of things, and all of a sudden I'm not performing like I should be. So how do we make that whole? How do we control that for you? Do we think that she's doing well? She doing all right? We have no idea, right? We have no idea. And I'm struck by this image. I grew up in a boating family, and I'm struck by this image of the plimsoll line. Anybody here grow up in a boating family? Anybody know what a plimsoll line is? So this line right here is not just for coloration. One, it's contrast. You can see this big ship on the horizon. Two, red paint is actually more resistant to marine organisms. And three, it's a very important mark. You don't get to put that red line wherever you want. So on a boat, you have something called freeboard, which is the distance between the waterline and the gunwales, or the breach point of the boat. This is the gunwale. And then you have draft, which is less important to our discussion. That's essentially how much water you need to not be aground. So having more freeboard in a boat is good. So this thing called a plimsoll line, which you may have seen, this is the safe resting spot of a boat in the water. So Plimsoll was a social reformer. Basically, he was in England, and he noticed that there were a bunch of ships going down, coming to the New World. And what was happening was the merchants were overloading the ships, so fewer would have to go to carry the same amount of cargo to the New World. Fewer ships go, cost less money. They would then over-insure the ships. So if the ships sunk in the North Atlantic, they were compensated. So who loses? Sailors. That's right. Who were not well compensated, who were not in a position to fend for themselves, right? So they called these coffin ships. So the idea is, if you can't see this line, don't get on the boat, right? But the line changes depending on what environment you're in. So if you're in tropical fresh waters or tropical salt water, you need less freeboard. You can weight that boat down more. You need less freeboard, right? More cargo can go on the ship. If you're in the harsh conditions of the winter North Atlantic, or even the Ross Sea down by Antarctica, you need a heck of a lot more freeboard. So your ability to be weighted down by cargo completely changes with the environment that you're in. You have a plimsoll line. It's not long before this boat goes under. The water is at the gunwales, right? There's no freeboard left. I mean, there's some here, but the gunwales are down here. So this wave is actually coming over. And it's easy to tell that this person is going underwater. What about her? Where is her plimsoll line? Where is your Clemson line? And how do we assess that for other people? How do we know that this colleague or myself or this person or Kendall is going underwater or he's close to the gunnels? And the problem is that the people that are most at risk are the least likely to seek help. So this are the PHQ 9 scores, which is just depression inventory. So they dichotomize these people into people that have low scores for depression and high scores for depression. So this group is the people that scored low on depression index. And they are more likely to tell a counselor, or more likely to seek help, less likely to feel like they're gonna be at risk if they disclose. They're more likely to seek help, less likely to be ashamed if they're depressed, as opposed to people that are depressed, that are much less likely to seek help, much less likely to be identified, more likely to feel ostracized, more likely to have the stigma. So the people that need the help the most are least likely to seek it, least likely to disclose. That sets us up for danger. And the reason is this: the prime directive of emergency medicine, the prime directive of this residency, at least has been, and I've been gone for 5 years, don't be weak, right? Be the good resident, work hard, right? Be the person that can pick up that next, you know, case in CCT or in the pods, what we used to call pods. You get the idea, right? Be strong, don't be weak. And the reason is that we are a tribe. And the most fearful thing for anyone in a tribe is to get kicked out of tribes. It's a very us versus them mentality. We want to be us. We want to be in the tribe. And we don't want to feel like we're outside of the tribe. We don't want to feel like we don't belong, like we can't make it. So how do we do this? How do we stay in our tribe, but yet pick the right road to resiliency? So these are the things that I think can help. These are things that build resiliency. And some science, not all science, has been used to make this slide, so in full disclosure. So address the stress in your life. If you feel like you're stressed out, if you're upset at your significant other, if you're mad at your program director, your assistant program director, if you feel like you're not good at ultrasound and that's, you know, sort of holding you back as a physician, address the stress. Be proactive about it. Manage your emotions. Recognize, you know, if that patient comes in and they, you know, are the same patient that comes in drunk every single weekend, you see them more often than you see your significant other. I remember those people. But manage that emotion. Realize that they're there, right? When I see, we have a huge drug addiction problem in Kentucky. Opiates are just rampant. I am fully aware that these people tick me off. But I go into it realizing that, addressing that mentality, understanding that that's my baggage. Practice positivity. So every night before I go to bed, I think of three great things that happened that day. I didn't come up with the three great things idea. It comes from a book called Enjoy Every Sandwich, which as you can tell, I do. But before I go to bed, before I can fall asleep, I have to think of three great things that happened that day. Sometimes it's I saw a trainee sort of make a connection and really something came together. Often my son, who was the kid running around up front in the beginning, you know, he's usually in there, right? My family, or you know, something went well at work, or whatever happened. I thought I was gonna be late for work, but I caught the lights, made it just on time. Three great things. And I find myself looking for things during the day, knowing that I'm gonna have to come up with three things tonight. So I find myself looking for positive things during the day, looking for positivity in my life. Deepen connectivity. I think this is critically important. You are part of a tribe, so rely on your tribe. Increase the density and the depth of the relationships with the people that you work with. Rely on them. It should be part of the tribe that the stress is normal, that feeling inadequate every once in a while is normal. Feeling like you're a bad doctor, you missed a diagnosis, is normal. The best physicians you know, some of which are in this room, feel like this every day. Damn, I missed that diagnosis. I should have gotten on top of that quicker. The best docs you know feel this way. It doesn't make you outside of the tribe to feel stressed out some days, to feel inadequate. Right, to feel like you're not good enough. It makes you part of the tribe. It's normal. We have to normalize the conversation around the stresses in our job. And once we do that, this begins to matter tremendously, that we are connected to the people around us. Reframe your thinking. I will talk about this at the end, the way you can look at something and see two different complete scenarios. And then clarify your purpose. You are not working in McDonald's. You're not working on Wall Street. What you do matters. You change people's lives every day. Today's Wednesday. Those of you that go into shift after this, you are going to change somebody's life today. And you'll do it tomorrow. And you'll do it the day after that. And you'll do it the day after that. Every day. You change somebody's life for the better. There's some science about this. These are four things that are linked to positive resiliency, hope, self-efficacy, control of your environment, and a feeling of commitment. Another paper by Raj, I mentioned this paper before. Things that are linked to resiliency, so getting enough sleep. Multiple coping mechanisms, so having several things you do. So maybe you exercise to help build, get rid of stress. You also spend time with your significant other. You also spend time with friends. You also read or practice mindfulness or meditation or whatever. You have multiple coping mechanisms. Because if you just go into the gym and you sprain your ankle, all of a sudden your coping mechanism is gone. If it's just your mother, you spend a lot of time talking with your mother, and all of a sudden she's intubated in the ICU with a MELD score of 40. Right? You have problems. Competence and social relatedness, so this idea of connectivity. There's a bunch of stuff in the non-medicine literature, optimism, facing fears, feeling like you have a moral compass, having some spiritual bearing. Good social support, we've seen that a bunch of times. Having positive role models, which is an issue, right? Your wellness is linked to the wellness of your faculty, right? Faculty model a bunch of things. This is a huge problem in the UK, where our physicians, are not role modeling great wellness strategies for the residents. Physical exercise, mental exercise, being flexible in its feeling of calling or commitment or vocation. So here's where I screwed up. Carlos, and I don't know for sure, but I've thought a hell of a lot about it since it happened, may have felt like I was kicking him out of the tribe. I took Carlos off clinical service, made him come to my office. I gave him a bunch of resources. Here's an employee assistance program. Here is this free service we have through GME where you can talk to somebody for four free sessions, and it's a psychologist. It's a nice resource to have. But here is what I did wrong, and I will regret for the rest of my life, is I interfaced with Carlos great as a program director. I did everything I could have done, everything I was taught to do by the people who taught me how to be a program director, people in this room, Dr. Renner, Dr. Lucchese, the people that I modeled myself after. Did everything I should do. I have no regrets there. What I didn't do is I didn't wrap Carlos up in a hug and interface with him as a human being and say, man, I know this sucks. I know it sucks, but I'll be here with you, minute by minute, if that's what it takes, until somebody else that you want comes along, you know, somebody else that you want to spend, you know, to spend this time with, or until you feel better. So I interfaced with Carlos as a program director and not well as a human being. And I sent him on the long, lonely walk to employee health. Get out of the tribe. You're off clinical service. Goodbye. You're somebody else's problem. Now, I know the things I do well, and I know the things I don't do well, and I'm not a counselor. That's not what I do well. So I punted that to people who do that better. But I should have gone with it, physically, mentally, emotionally, and I didn't. There are two communication strategies, and this is stereotypical. It's not 100%, but there are male and female communication strategies, right? If you go to a male and you present him with a problem, what do you get back? The solution. That's right. Here's a potential solution. If you go to a woman and you present her with a problem, what do you get back? Commiseration. Right? You often get back commiseration. So maybe we need a more female strategy in dealing with other people's problems when it comes to this, when people come to us with issues. These are four things I have heard people say when somebody disclosed that they were not feeling well, that they were suffering, they were having a difficult shift. These are four quotes I've heard people say. You should think about all the good things in your life, not help. You should try snacking during your shift. Probably even less helpful. The least helpful is it's really not that bad. And the most helpful here is, man, that really sucks. I'm sorry. Maybe follow it up with, yeah, I've been there before. I've felt like that before. I'm sorry that's happening to you. There are vaccinations that you can take. Don't believe Jenny McCarthy. Vaccinations save lives. Vaccinations that you can take for resiliency. Connect with people. Increase the density and the connectivity of your relationships with people, both medical and non-medical. It's critically important. Carlos died of isolation. No matter what his death certificate says, he died of isolation. He couldn't reach out, and we didn't reach in enough. And there are literally hundreds of people that wouldn't. He was a UK student, so there were plenty of people that stayed at UK, went to other services, that cared about him. His entire residency class, one of which is a board-certified psychiatrist, cared about him. His faculty cared about him. I cared about him. But we didn't want to remove control, right? We didn't want to remove control and step in and say, hey, man, you look like you're having trouble. Let me talk to you about that. We just said, well, if he wants to reach out, I'll be there. Wasn't enough. I have a friend who's an attending physician in Philadelphia, and she was actively suicidal for a long time. If you follow anything I do, you'll know who it is because she's been very public about this story. She and I work a lot together now. And her kid was very, very sick, and she had a lot of guilt over that because it was a brain tumor. She felt like she should have picked it up earlier. She's a doctor. And she got very, very depressed, and people would say, how you doing? And she would say, it's nothing that 200 units of insulin wouldn't fix. What the hell is that? Right? She's basically disclosing that she's suicidal. Right? And people are like, that's weird. you want to check it out now? Right? They didn't want to reach in. So if you see something, say something. You guys all live in New York. You get told that a lot. reach out. I don't think anyone is going to say, hey, mind your business, right? Or guys, figure out the two or three things in your future practice that bother you, bother your partners. The two or three things that you bother you about residency. And don't just come and complain to Teresa about it. Come up with solutions. Your program director cares. Your APDs care about your wellness. But they can't fix everything, and they don't know everything. We're going to have to figure this out together. So come up with a working plan. Come up with a working group. Nobody wants to be on a committee. Don't make a wellness committee. Make a task force. But work on two or three things. Don't work on 10 things. Work on two or three. But be active. Don't just suck it up. Don't just deal with it. Find something that you can fix. And even if it's incrementally better tomorrow, and then the next day, and the next day, you're going to find out eventually in 6 or 8 or 12 months that this is better. And maybe there are two other things that we can focus on. And I'm sure that the leadership of this department will engage you on that. Would be happy to be learner-centered and focused on the things that you want to improve. But you got to work with them. You can't just come and sit down in the office and vomit up the problem and then walk out. Exercise is an immunization for resiliency. Adequate exercise. Adequate sleep. Okay, not like this. Maybe like this. Adequate sleep is an immunization. My son, who in my mind is perfect in every way, if I don't get enough sleep, I am a dick to my son. And I can see myself doing it. And I want to stop, but I can't stop. For me, sleep is intimately tied to my resiliency as a father, my ability to manage his behavior. Right? Where I'm like, God, Jesus, put the pots and pans away. You have all the Tupperware out. You're making a mess. But he's 3 years old. His job description is make a mess. That's all. Right? Eat, sleep, make a mess, repeat. So if I don't get enough sleep, I can see it happen. I'm very aware of that. It's very tied to my resiliency. Right? Find out where you get recharged. Maybe it's your family, maybe it's your kids, maybe it's your friends, maybe it's your significant other, maybe it's Nintendo, maybe it's fiction or nonfiction. Maybe it's, C1's the old name. Whatever it is, find what it is. Protect it. Right? And there needs to be institutional responses. You have to engage in your own wellness, but there also needs to be institutional responses. And I don't mean program, I don't mean departmental. I mean institutional responses. I mean organized medicine. Right? So downstate level, American Hospital Association level, ACGME level, the AMA, there needs to be responses bigger than all of us. And we're starting to see, although this literature was published in 2009, we're starting to see that this is going to happen, right? Where physician wellness is going to be a quality indicator. And it already is. Mayo and Stanford are treating this as an indicator for the institution. UK has just started this. Physician engagement is an indicator of how executive leadership is doing. Because I'll tell you what healthcare systems care about. They care about the bottom line, they care about money, and they care about patient safety. And we can now begin to tie this in, physician wellness, into both those things. Both of them. It's going to cost less money if your physicians are well in regards to recruitment, retraining, productivity, and patients are much more safe, right, when your physicians are well and rested and making good decisions. So there's some keys. Vaccines save lives, find where your resilience comes from, where your batteries are recharged. I would say that, you know, if you forget all the other slides, clarify your purpose. Understand the impact you're having, which I still have yet to address. Increase your social connectedness. Get adequate exercise. Get adequate downtime, right? Mental downtime. Protect. You know, when I was a program director here, I did say you have to protect your study time, right? If you don't have ass in chair time to sit and read and study, you are never going to be a phenomenal physician. And I think that's true. But you also need to sit down and protect your downtime, right? Your mental downtime. And get adequate sleep. Let's talk about reframing and impact, and then I'll conclude. This is an actual email to me and my resident. So this was at the end of a peak shift. We have a big children's hospital. We get referred a lot of cases. This happened to be a primary case that was sent to us. This kid had this petechial rash on the face. I didn't know what to make of it. My shift was over in about half an hour. It had been a monstrous career shortening shift. We had just been shelled for 10 hours. Kid has a weird petechial rash on the face. I go examine the kid, physical exam essentially normal otherwise. Check the platelets, platelets are normal. Kid's not coughing. I don't know. I turn to the resident. I'm like, just get the kid out of here. Like, I don't want to sign this case out to the next attending. Like, I don't know what's going on, but the kid looks well. Just make him evaporate. And the resident says, really? And that was enough. That pushback was enough for me to say, no, not really. I'm being lazy. I'm being intellectually lazy. Dig in. Forget about your other cases. Dig into this case. Figure out what's going on. And it didn't take long to figure it out. So this resident pushed back on her attending and her program director just a little bit. And what's the impact? She saved this kid's life. Right? She was being choked by her mother's boyfriend. And I am fully confident this kid would have been dead. He had already gotten to choking her, and she had a younger sibling. So not only did my resident save this kid, she saved a kid she'd never even seen. Saved their life. And pushed back against the program, which is not easy to do. This guy went to jail. This is the impact you have. And it's just a regular Monday, regular Thursday. It's Wednesday afternoon. Like every day. This could be the PDD this afternoon. So this is the last thing I'll show, and we'll conclude right after this. Has anybody seen this? So this is stunning. Now, I will tell you there's a little production value in this, and they found a woman who is beautiful, right? And they've got music playing in the background. So there's a little cheese value, but I want you to think about the impact. Right? And think if this could have been your last shift. This, again, happens to be a PEDS case. But think about the impact that you have.
Kelly, 2 o'clock, the baby was here at 1:36.
My favorite part of the day was getting home with Eli for the first time and to rock him in, watch him sleep.
10 years ago, my husband and our baby boy and I were in a horrific car accident. Eli was 14 weeks old, so I was just a new baby. Life was